Okay. Good morning, everybody. Like I said, there were some forces conspiring against me, trying to prevent me from coming yesterday fall afternoon, but eventually I made it, and it's a really good feeling to be here. I'm also actually very thankful for the change in the order of the talks, because without knowing, I just found out that Chris Weaver, who's just been presenting the talk, has actually picked up some of the ideas that I'm also going to expand or focus on in my talk. And that is actually this question of, you know, how do we think of collaborative visualization in terms of, like, what kinds of influence or what kinds of insights that people make by using the visualization, how should this, what kind of implications should this have on the data underlying the visualization? And shouldn't they be more closely connected? And that's actually one of the main points in the work we've been doing on trying to figure out what are different ways of going about integrating collaboration and visualization. And what I chose to focus in this talk and to share with you is basically an idea of a particular way, maybe, of reconceptualizing the way we consider this integration of collaboration and visualization in a way a bit similar to the commonly used approaches nowadays, and yet a little bit different, with the hope that we can, maybe can get a little bit different kinds of usages of collaborative visualization applications. So what I'm going to do in this talk, I'm going to, just to set a bit of a context, remind us of the typical examples, then focus on the underlying conceptual models guiding not all, but let's say most of the work in the area, and then ask a question, how could we think a bit differently on that, propose a possible and alternative complementary model, and then dive in directly in some examples from our own work where we've tried to explore what kind of usefulness does this kind of conceptualization of the way we can build collaborative or understand collaborative visualization, what kind of use does it have in building the applications, in providing novel kinds of insights for the users, and what can we learn from that. So much for that. Just to get us going, a few images you're probably very well familiar with, seen them probably in one or the other talk. Why I'm bringing up these images, like the early seminar or pioneering work from Ben Schneiderman and colleagues on formulating for the first time more systematically the ideas of information visualization, and also proposing some conceptual models how to think about using visualization to support human cognition. And then some of the examples, we took up these models at some point along the development of the field and asked, hey, but wouldn't it be better if we could do this collaboratively? And how can we go about injecting collaboration into visualization? For example, by adding different kinds of annotations and manipulations you've also heard in the previous talk, allowing groups of people to share insights that they get by using the visualization for data exploration. Obviously, the idea is relatively simple. Just as we hope that a single user gets insights from visual representation manipulating complex data, we add more users and we should get more insights. And actually, this basic idea, as simple and as powerful, is also reflected in many titles of the tools that have been built. For example, the Many Eyes system, which was one of the first more large-scale tools allowing different users to collaborate on visualization, actually directly mimics this idea. Currently, as the field has matured, we will find, as you are probably also aware, many different terms trying to say about different takes on how can we use visual representation to support groups of users collecting and discovering and sharing insights collaboratively. So some people have talked about social data analysis, others have preferred the terms collaborative visualizations, others have talked about collaborative visual analysis and then switched to collaborative visual analytics. So one could say, ask the question, is this just about terminology, or are there some underlying fundamental differences in understandings? What I'm going to do in this talk is to avoid this terminology issue. I'm going to basically say that while there are some small differences in the understandings, there is a basic underlying common assumption. So I'm going to say we might just as well, for the purpose of this talk, use these terms interchangeably. Also, as has been pointed out at some point, well, if you think about different ways of supporting collaboration in visualization, obviously we know the different situations in which people can collaborate. They can collaborate in co-located settings, they can collaborate in distributed settings, synchronously or asynchronously. And as the field has matured initially, there was a lot of work on building general purpose tools, and from what I've understood from the little bit of the last talk I was able to hear, this talk also picked up on the fact that, you know, increasingly there is attention to, can we really have just general purpose tools, or do we need to go a bit more application specific and then learn from these domain specific applications, how we can generalize this. And so a little bit more attention has also been currently given to those questions like what kind of specific support to specific different kinds of purposes of such collaborative analysis require and how can we learn from that. And in fact, for many reasons, one can say that, you know, the field of visual analytics has kind of unified all of, or connected all these approaches by focusing largely on these analytical processes that are performed when using the visualization as a major focus in the field of collaborative visual analysis. And why I'm bringing up this diagram, which all of you are surely familiar with, is because it's interesting to see where does the collaboration come into picture when we think about it. And so typically what you all know is that visual analytics we could divide in three large pillars. One is concerned with different ways we have to worry about data analysis. We've heard something about it on the previous talk. The other is about a choice of different kinds of visual metaphors, efficient implementation, interaction, navigation techniques, and so on and so forth. And the third, one is what is broadly called human factors, which lists a whole series of things we have to care about when designing effective visual applications. Cognition, perception, such as the also very early ones, and then among them also collaboration, saying it's just a facet of these human factors. While this certainly has been useful, it also, as I'm trying to show in this talk, has some fundamental consequences of how we approach the design of such systems. So commonly, as you will find in any kind of state-of-the-art paper or textbook, you would say, well, if you want to structure visual analytics, essentially we can say it's about using visualization to support two structural types of tasks. Either we are trying to confirm or explain known hypotheses, our assumptions about why something holds or a decision won't take, or we are into exploratory analysis, trying to find out what are the possible meanings of the data, what possible courses of action could we take, and then go circle back and actually use the insights from the data to actually support why this is valid. Obviously, according to this view, when we then inject the collaboration component, it remains basically the same framing. And what we then say is, well, in order to support groups of users to do this most effectively, we can have different kinds of sharing in this process. Initially started with sharing views, what you have also seen probably also in the talks preceding in the preceding days, such as producing visualizations by different users and sharing the ready visualization of specific kind of data with others, or sharing insights by commenting on them, or actually sharing the data sets that we have and the visualization we have built upon, and then allowing the collaboration to take place. And in fact, most of the early and also still very relevant systems have then focused on trying to structure and systematically develop different types of functionalities to support this kind of collaborations. We've heard in a previous talk a lot about annotations to the data discovered by the visualization that can be shared. There was a lot of work on different types of commentings of the visualization and connecting the comments with the specific spots in the visualization. A lot of work of pointing users to interesting parts of the visualization by, for example, doing things like visual bookmarks, and so on, and so forth. Another example, also in the asynchronous domain, which is representative for all the work, which is now trying to figure out what if we go into specific application domains, for example, here in the digital forensics area, we will still find exactly these kinds of classes of functionalities that have actually been proposed and developed in very early systems with a slight maybe modification for the specific application domain. Of course, also very early on, the collocated scenario has also been an issue. And of course, the collocated scenario brings a number of related problems with it, such as synchronizing the views in real time, viewing different displays and input devices, and multimodal interaction, where some of the challenges also of current visualization efforts in the collaborative setting are. What all of these different approaches, and I'm a little bit simplifying here for the sake of making the argument, can be boiled down to is the reliance of an underlying reference model. And that is a very famous and established information visualization reference model, which is very useful in building visualization, already early proposed in the late 90s, which basically say, well, we first have to worry about acquiring the raw data, putting it in suitable kinds of data structures that we can work flexibly with it. We've heard also problems about it in the last talk. from which we have to provide suitable or different selectable kind of visual structurings to be provided in flexible and interactively manipulatable views. Based on that, also types of activities have been defined a little bit more closely that we have to take care in these different steps, including especially also later to focus on different kinds of analysis we should support. And then in actually a very famous paper on design, guidelines for collaborative visualization, a very important and good, interesting paper on how we can conceptualize this whole field, a point has been made that, you know, we can inject collaboration in any of these steps, not just as frequently done initially into sharing the observations and the insights part into the visualization. And actually, that was a point where I felt kind of synchronized to what Chris, you were saying before, saying, yes, but if you take this seriously, shouldn't have visualization also impact the data underlying it, meaning the insights discovered by the people shouldn't, and annotations, that shouldn't they also reflect the data that is the basis for the visualization, which is an important point because I fully agree with Chris on that, that this has been relatively little explored so far, and most of the effects that the collaboration has is in these two areas, meaning that we can have different kinds of views based on what other people have found out. We can have different kinds of insights based on what people, other users have found out, but relatively little example exists where this has a direct influence of how the underlying data is modeled and what kind of data we actually have in the collection stemming from this observation, which can fundamentally influence actually the whole presentation of the data itself, and then in consequence the kind of insights people can develop. In a way, one aspect that already early has been accounted for related to this is also the other reference model, which is frequently used in combination with the information visualization model as a guideline for building this application. And this is also a very widespread sense-making model trying to explain how people go about information seeking activities in rich, complex problem tasks or rich and complex information spaces. And I believe you already had the lecture on one of the previous days about collaborative sense making, which surely also addressed aspects like that. So I'm not going to go into detail, but the basic idea is that while looking for information, it is never just a process of finding the right information or insight, but it is a process of using the information we have to formulate conceptual schemas that allow us to organize information as a way of interpreting its meaning, which in turn leads us to a different understanding of what kind of information we may actually need to look for, so what kind of information may be relevant for, which in turn enriches these schemas, and so on and so forth, until we have found insights that allow us to act upon solving our problem, which then again changes our understanding, and the whole loop starts again. So based on the integration of these two models, this is basically the underlying assumption that Jeffrey Hare and his colleague have put in their paper, which still has a large impact on the design of these applications, is we can consider how in this model we can integrate collaborative aspects. And they've done great work in taking a look at, well, you know, collaboration is not new. There is a vast amount of work in the area of collaborative computer-supported work. So what can we learn from there into informing us how to design these applications? And not surprisingly, they've come up with a list with all the typical aspects you would find in any kind of collaborative scenarios you have to take care of, such as how do you divide and coordinate the work between the people, how do you provide for some kind of support for figuring out common ground or shared understanding or awareness of other people's action, how do we incentivize people actually to use this and to share the insight they discovered, which is actually an element which is frequently overlooked, or let's say not overlooked, but not so much in the focus when we talk about the visualization system. But it is critical because what use do we have from all the fancy functionalities we build if the people are not prepared to share hard-won data and insights? And as we will see in an example that I will bring up shortly, this is all but a trivial issue because it is not only dependent on what we know how to build incentive models, reputation system, and the like, but it is also intrinsically connected to a specific domain and the traditions of the types of working practices and what is seen as appropriate or practiced or not by the people involved there. So this notion of sharing can be a very problematic and can be a big challenge regardless of what kind of fancy functionalities we provide to support it. You will see in a minute why I highlight exactly these things. And obviously all the other related issues, such as how to account for things such as trust or support consensus and decision making. They've provided also some pointers on how we can map this into appropriate design issues in such systems, such as how do we deal with shared views. We need to provide specific kind of pointers allowing people to understand their own references or connect the sharing of insights about a specific part of visualization with metadata on the users themselves, like who are the users who discover these insights, in order to allow things which are of crucial importance in any collaborative scenario, and which is assessing the validity and the relevance of the insights proposed, which are not only done, we will also see that, based on the presented data, but also very much, as in every human scenario, implicitly or explicitly, based on what we know about the person who is suggesting a specific interpretation of the data. And that is already a little bit of a clue, which shows that this whole idea of starting from data, going to the visualization, going to the manipulation and exploration with the users and sharing insights, is all but trivial, because there are a number of issues which depend not only on this performing this process from data to visualization, but which depend upon how different people, different users actually understand and interpret the data presented, which may or actually is not only a function of what they see out of its visual representation. And that is a key issue which has been known for long in the area of collaborative work, but it, because it's also very complex, but which, so for that reason, also tends to get a little bit less addressed in current work. Also because it's very hard to deal with, and also because, as we've seen, I'm relating this, sorry, Chris, if I'm overinterpreting, I'm relating this also to the example presented before on this impact of annotations to the data model, because this is directly related to that, because it means that different kinds of interpretations people have on the data may are based on not only how the data is presented, but on their different kinds of backgrounds, mental models, and so on and so forth. And once we ask the question, how can we map these two changes into the data, this becomes really problematic, because we need to make sure that if we allow insights of people to change the data, how can people understand why this data has been changed in this way, and will they agree with it? And if not, how do we deal with the differences? And this already leads to the question which comes slowly into our notion that, you know, there's this question of perspectives that individual users have, and a question like how easy it is to understand what a perspective is, and how to model it, and how to embed it into a visualization system. Because a number of functionalities I've kind of just screened through before, they could be said that they treat with representing perspectives, and they do, like a specific visual view created by the user, a specific annotation or comment on a specific pattern of data. They're all expressions of personal perspectives. But the question is this enough? Is there more to it? And what I'm trying to suggest is, yes, that there is, and that maybe in order to deal with this complexity, that there is more to this personal perspective than just an externalization of what the users have done with the data, that we may need also to consider other ways of conceptualizing what we understand and how we can build such kind of collaborative visual applications. So in the literature, you will also find a number of very useful design considerations and suggestions how to go about designing effective collaborative visualization systems based on this kind of integration of these reference models from information visualization, sense making, and some lessons from collaborative systems. I've just put an extra key note for you to read it, but to see that this has been very thorough work, and a lot of applications are actually implementing these, and it helps them to work well. But interestingly enough, a lot of these suggestions actually deal with core concepts of what is commonly asked when in the area of collaborative work we ask, what should we be concerned with when we develop a collaborative system? Shared artifacts, artifact histories, artifact summaries, we've seen before, common ground, and so on and so forth. If this is so, already, you know, there was a bug in our mind when we were thinking about it, like, is it really correct that this collaboration is just a side facet which is kind of injected into this whole information visualization model? It does produce applications at work, but maybe we could have different kind of applications if we kind of gave more prominence to this aspect of collaboration. And so we started already thinking about how could we do that? And I'm talking like about maybe 10 years back when we done some first work in that direction. How can we do that? How can we find out, you know, like maybe different ways of what kind of reference models we could relate to in order to help us with this little bit more focused view of the role of correlation, the conceptualization of collaboration, and the conceptualization and possibilities to implement into practice the richness of what it means to have a personal perspective. Incidentally, also recently, there has been some work which has tried to move also attention in this area by focusing or suggesting that specific challenges for designing collaborative visualization systems are also, and has to be fair and say not anymore because the field of visualization has developed so far, actually the visual representation interaction mechanisms, but because the collaboration is, if collaboration is the focus, then it's actually, we should start with understanding what do we know about the users, what determines the way the users work, what determines the dynamics of multiple participants collaborating with each other, different types of tasks in the collaborative context, actually similar like to what has been done in the field of information visualization very early on, the famous data by task taxonomy proposed to see how we can represent different types of data in different appropriate ways. And also move to the issues such as cognition in collaborative setting, supporting consensus making or shared insights and so on and so forth. In fact, some of the recent work also suggests that it has come time to think a little bit more about putting the focus on specific application scenarios and domains, because all of these questions are very difficult to be answered in a generic way. Of course, there is also work in the collaborative work area which has tried to provide some structures and classes and schemes of different types of ways of dealing with that. But a lot of this work, and actually that's a tradition of this work, is that actually if you want to have a full understanding, you have to always ground your collaboration system design into the actual context for which you are designing, because otherwise it's very difficult to get these intricacies of how the user groups understand different types of data, how they work with sharing data, are they more or less likely to do it, how could they be incentivized, and what is for them an interpretation, and what kind of functionalities they would actually need to accept them as a valuable support in the types of work they do. So if you take this seriously, then actually before we start with our information visualization reference model and so on and so forth, you have to ask a whole range of questions which are commonly asked every time you develop a system for a specific application scenario, and especially when you develop a system for a collaborative use. This incidentally also includes, by the way, the question of what kind of social group is the system supposed to support. Now, in most of the collaborative visualization systems, this assumption that there is a sharing of insights and collaboration doesn't really address the question, what kind of a social configuration are we addressing? Is it an existing community, meaning this kind of a group already has some social conventions, incentives, knowledge sharing practice of sort? Is it just a general public or a loosely tied social network, or is it a large mass of individual participants which are in no connection with each other, but which every piece of information they provide, they kind of provide a bit to a collective knowledge, like the kind of the notion of the crowdsourcing aspects and so on and so forth. Why is this important? Well, if you ask any person from the collaboration area, he or she will tell you, well, you can't design a collaborative system until you ask, I have answered this question. What kind of social group or social setting are you addressing? Because this comes with a whole range of social dynamics, working practices attached, which you have to be aware of and account for in your design. And depending on what you design for, it may turn one way or the other. So, to summarize this, and I've been rushing a little bit to save the time for the actual case study, so I'm going to try to slow up a little bit now to not overwhelm you with the speed. If you summarize this to make a point, we could say that, you know, a little bit simplified, one way of designing collaborative visual analysis tools is to start from the visualization and add in collaboration, start from these reference models I've talked about. But if, like I've tried to argue, we want to put more focus on if the actual focus is on the collaborative activity, if we really want this tool to support the actual collaboration, you know, this begs the question, Couldn't we start the other way around? Start from the collaboration as the goal and then see how we can inject visualization to support that and see if we can come up with different kinds of systems or what kinds of benefits or challenges such an approach may pose. And that's actually what they did. And so if you started this way around, obviously what you come across are in this research community also very well known and existing models which help people structure their understanding of dealing with collaboration processes. I will show them in a few minutes. So we can start from collaboration models such as the well-known and kind of very simple but yet still very kind of a powerful model of the people artifact framework of collaboration, and then include some models which explain or have tried and been quite successful in doing that for a long period of time, explain how different people possibly stemming from different knowledge backgrounds, different disciplinary traditions, different also social or practice backgrounds, how these people from very different environments actually are able to collaborate with each other, and what role specific types of shared artifacts, so-called boundary objects, have in this process, and what role specific types of processes, such as perspective making, perspective taking, which I'm going to explain in a moment, what role these processes have. So what if we can start from these models, figure out what they teach us about how visualization could help these kinds of collaboration, and then try to extend these kinds of models with what we know from possibilities from the field of visualization and visual analytics. And that has actually been the approach that we have been following and tried to put in practice, because it has its fair share of problems and some interesting benefits. Because if you go through it, the models actually seem, you know, quite simple enough. This is one of the basic models of collaboration work, saying like, what is the possible role of technology in supporting collaboration can be understood if you map out this simple diagram which says the participants who engage in a collaborative work will always have some direct communications channels which support their understanding, but more often than not, in this case, especially in asynchronous scenarios, they will be using different kinds of computer-supported objects, which incidentally don't need to be computer-supported, they can also be real world objects and documents as we know them, to coordinate their work, to communicate through these kind of documents, to change, and as they change them, communicate different kinds of feedback to the other participants, and in the process develop a shared understanding of what it is they're trying to do, of the information they are trying to exchange, and of how the different tasks, results, use, knowledge of the participants relate to each other and can be brought to help for the task at hand. Obviously, just as soon as we see this, we can think of, hey, of course, we need different special kind of shared artifacts which take advantage of visualization to support this kind of processes. So this is an entry point to do that. The notion of boundary object has been hugely successful from the moment it has been introduced, because it has been a very powerful, simple, but really kind of a very flexible model of explaining how is it that collaboration can work between people with very different understanding, backgrounds, and so on, which do not necessarily have all the time in practice in this world to go thoroughly into discussing what do I think about this and what do you think about that and how can we agree on some shared understanding. Because also what practice teaches us, most often than not, the shared understanding is not there. It's not that just because we've talked, I'm going to agree to your position and you to mine. We may have some degree of understanding what the other people are saying, but more likely we are going to still kind of, to a great extent, keep our personal perspectives. And actually in performing work, also in modern organization, this high specialization is needed. And for work to be done very well, each of these different participants has to stick with his or her field of expertise in order to be able to perform this practice. So how can these things automatically come together if actually people kind of, let's put it in a provoking way, disagree most of the time? And so this boundary object model stems from ethnographic studies of, actually I believe it was museums back then, but then also different fields trying to figure out how different people also distributed in time and sometimes in space manage this challenge of coordinating their work and different meanings. And it suggests that one way of doing that, it seems to be very successful in practice, is that there is a special notion, an object which emerges from this work, in which, such as, for example, documents or in the museum examples, it exhibits in the actual museums. So artifacts of work, in whose creation, modifications, and so on, a number of different people are involved, each from his or her own perspective, each with his or her own expertise, who bring this perspective expertise into the project, into the object, for example, into the document, in a way that connects it to the perspective of the other participants, without the need to explicitly agree on one shared understanding how it is that we all agree on seeing the task, the problem, the world, the exhibit, and so on and so forth. And what this, of course, requires for this to work is some means of translation or connection or discovery of relationships between these different perspectives, which are provided by this specific type of objects called, in that sense, to refer to this property, boundary objects, which incidentally, and that's also a big challenge in current visualization, collaborative visualization, also have a property. In order for them to work like that, they also need to be adaptive. They need to be able to change and evolve over time while still keeping this property of connecting different perspectives to each other. Related to this model is another one. This is this so-called perspective-making, perspective-taking model proposed in the mid-90s, actually in the field of organization sciences, by two researchers who have tried to kind of map out their understanding, how can we conceptualize the processes and the way that these different, very specialized, what they called communities of knowing, groups of people who share certain things, such as expertise, cultural background, or professional background within the organization, and which distinguishes them from others. So how can these very specialized groups of people working typically, their case was a large knowledge-intensive organizations, how can they effectively collaborate across their knowledge boundaries? And they basically proposed a model, which I'm going to be very roughly and simplified, summarizing in a simplified way, saying that a way that these processes actually work is by two related processes. One is the so-called perspective making, which is about participants in a certain social grouping, in a certain discipline, in a certain community of practice, in a certain area of specialization, in which they express their view on the importance and interpretation of data, of the interpretation and relevance of knowledge, specific parts of knowledge to be applied to the task of hand, in the way which is common for their field, in the common vocabulary, in with the common value judgments behind it, with the common understandings of what is more important, what is less important, what is more likely to succeed, and what not. So this is the perspective making. They say that in order for these people, in order to be able to exchange their insights, work together, combine knowledge with people from the other such community of knowing, they need to engage in a process they term perspective taking, which is trying to understand or get some kind of understanding about the underlying world of knowledge of this other community. What kind of vocabulary these people use? What kind of meaning do they attach to the words? So what is actually the, what are the hidden assumptions between the terms they use? And then as a third step, to try to find some links, not to agree to assume their perspective, but to try to find some links between this world of knowledge, their vocabularies, their terminology, their important concepts, their data, their results, establish some links and relations to their way of seeing things, to their knowledge, their concepts, their data, their results, their problems, and so on. And what they suggested that this problem, this process of establishing this link between perspective taking and perspective making is that it could be supported through boundary objects, that these are the types of objects which, by definition, allow users to express different perspectives which can then coexist and put in context to each other. And so they say that by the integral of these processes, perspective making, expressing things as we know it from our community or our social and disciplinary background, perspective taking, trying to understand the way the other community expresses knowledge, what they seem relevant, what assumptions they have, and establishment of the links between this unfamiliar and the familiar world of knowledge, boundary objects, collaboration between such different settings and exchange of knowledge can effectively happen. Fine enough, and it's a very, very kind of insightful article, and the model kind of makes sense. But the question is then, yeah, okay, how do we turn this into practice? How can we design these kind of model objects which have these kinds of properties and allow these own perspectives to be expressed, perspectives of others to be examined and connections to be developed. They proposed some types of objects they think that could perform such functions, but if you take a look at it, they include on one hand some kind of like organization schemes. This relates, by the way, directly to sense making, but they also include some kind of what initially also has been visual representations, such as causal maps or narrative maps, outlining the specific ways specific groups of people think about certain things. Obviously, this also immediately moves us to the idea that, well, this is actually the great place where we could inject what we know from visualization and the tools and the functionalities there in order to support this process of collaborative knowledge exchange and analysis. And so the basic idea is at a very conceptual level to say, okay, now we can take the shared artifact model and this perspective-making, perspective-taking model, combine them and try to provide a kind of a model which can just help us to guide our thinking with what we have to worry about if we want to design a system for collaborative analysis by visual means, allowing different users to effectively exchange this, their insights and knowledge. And basically this says that we could consider a kind of a shared visualization to be a kind of a, by definition, multi-perspective object. That means now a shared object which has to have the ability of representing different perspectives from the outset and not at the end when it is constructed from the underlying data we have, or at least allowing the shared object in terms of visualization to reflect different perspectives of the users that are engaged with investigating the data, not only at the level of the finished visualization, but also at the level of the underlying data, and also at the level of how visualization changes with the interpretations these different groups may have. Now, obviously, and then support these different perspectives to be put into relation and links between the different views to be established. Now, what seems like a simple idea is actually, what we found out, not at all that straightforward to implement in practice. So what we've tried to ask is like, okay, fine enough, this seems to make sense. It could be an alternative take on the common visual analytics approaches to start from collaboration, then add visualization in this case, trying to design it in a multi-perspective way from the outset. How can we do that in practice? And what kind of added value do we have? Is it worth the hassle? And what kind of implications it may have on how we think about these kind of systems? So we've done this in a few project and case studies. I'm not going to go through all of them for reasons of time. In very different application scenarios, ranging from asynchronous collaboration to also collocated visual collaboration, and also recently extending this to involve large groups of crowd-based scenarios where groups of unrelated participants in the sense of a crowd can use the visual system in order to contribute to the insights to be discovered, in this case in a fashion domain. What I would like to focus now is to walk us through with the time we have remaining, which is how much? 20 minutes? 15 minutes. Oh, okay. So I better hurry up. On how we've done this in a concrete case where we've developed a tool for a collaborative visual exploration and construction of social networks from historical multimedia collections from historians, for historians. This has been developed in a European project, which actually aimed at finding out different ways of combining human and machine intelligence to support new classes of scenarios when analyzing multimedia data. And what we've tried in our field, in our part, to focus on is on a specific application domain. So we've considered the application context in which groups of researchers in the field of history, actually more specifically in our application case, these were historians investigating the history of European integration, how they work and discover relationships between people, places and events in available material. And we set out to try to support this kind of collaborative analysis of relationships by developing a tool for collaborative visual construction and exploration of social networks from co-occurrence of persons in multimedia documents such as images or stills from videos. Why? Well, because in the humanist tradition, in this historical area, working with multimedia data is actually not something they do very much. They still very much rely on texts. At the same time, like in all the different fields we are facing today, they also are facing the so-called big data problem. There's so much amount of information, especially since this regards the recent history, the last 50 years of European integration, that is impossible to be processed in the common traditional way of so-called close reading of inspecting a detailed individual documents, and also they have to take account not only of text, but of the increasing volume of multimedia documents, reflecting a lot of potentially interesting insights that may not have been documented in the traditional textual ways. So increasingly in the humanist digital humanities, there is this idea, can we augment existing practices with so-called distant reading, trying to observe structural patterns and relations between the artifacts we have without actually taking a look at every single one. Thing that for us from the computer science is as normal and say good morning, for them is a big leap, not just in the sense of taking novel technology, but in the sense of changing their interpretative process of the way they understand how can we reach valid conclusions. So what we've done is to understand how can we bring such visual exploration in this kind of discipline and also in a tradition that is not used to working very much collaboratively, also in a tradition where individual participants are not used to readily share their assumptions until they've really thought them through and are sure that there is a plausibility in the observations and have checked all the sources and have written up the documents to then present what they consider a kind of a possibly almost finished insight. So how can you support this kind of participants who traditionally are not inclined to share just assumptions, pieces of insights with others, to engage in the collaborative exploration by visual means? So in order to come close, we've done the usual tour de force, I will call it, the user-centered process of going to the users, doing the interviews, the workshops, figuring out what they do, building some mockups and prototypes, figuring out what they could do and how our ideas, what we could use the visualization for, could relate to that, how we could support what we kind of found the metaphor for, kind of a detective work, which is what they do in collecting evidence, formulating supporting hypotheses, where, and that's interesting later for the visualization, the process of analyzing the data we have and getting insights is for them essentially connected to the process of collecting this data. Because with every new piece of data they collect, for them chances are the picture can turn completely different than from what they assume the causal relations or the insights are. Also, the very collection of the documents and the inspections of their relevance and validity is essential in their process. So already here we see that this formulation of insights is not something that in this case comes at the end. It is intrinsically connected also with what is at the beginning and moves back and forth. So the insights from what we would say the visualization that we wanted to build for them would also need to reflect the changes in the data. And also as new data would come, they themselves should be able to contribute as a part of building their personal perspective. This should also influence the way the visualization is designed. So we've developed a number of user stories, what are important things in their work to support, and we then focus on this particular one also for reasons of feasibility. So how can we help them to deal with historical photos which they have in abundance? We worked with the institute in Luxembourg, the CVC Institute for, in French, Centre Virtuel de la Connaissance sur l'Europe, which was especially dedicated to the researching the history of European integration. And they had an archive of around, 3,500 images, which were kind of sorted out, and then many more not sorted out, to help them apply some kind of system of analyzing co-occurrences of people in photos and building social graphs of them to assume possible relationships or discover possible relationships between actors in this integration process. In doing so, we've identified the main requirements and what we then turned into design principles, what would be important for this application domain. And interestingly enough, what we did is not, we took our models and went to the people, okay, tell us how we best apply these models to you. No, the other way around. We went to the setting, went to the people, figured out what they need, formulated the requirements, and what happened is it turned out, look, actually what we found out that they need relates very well to these models we've postulated before as a possible conceptual model, so it could make sense to apply it in practice. Discovery and presentation of multiple perspectives was essential to them. They needed a visual interface not for what they would understand as exploration of data. They needed a visual interface. They responded very well to the mockups, as an interface for interpretive activities, for interpretative activities. That means they need it as a way of analyzing, explaining, comparing, relating, discussing about what they see in the data. And this turns also the attention of the design of the system in a specific direction. The transparency of how the data is processed to reach the representation which is presented was of extreme importance for them, because they question every single step in the process. And we can't just assume, well, you know, this is a graph-based visualization. It's based on co-occurrences. People co-appearing will be connected by a link. Period. Yes, but how exactly? Why is the line here and this one is not there? How many co-occurrences are needed? What? How do you know that this is exactly this person? Oh, but this is a probability of 65%. That's not how they work. So we need to figure out a way how to combine these techniques we know from our field in building this kind of visualization with the way they see the world, and in a way which allows them to express own perspective, connect them to each other, and find ways of the expressing their insights in ways which can influence not only the visualization but also the underlying data structures. So I'm going to skip the technical details since I'm running out of time. We basically done that by integrating system-based face recognition from the photos to generate a graph of possibly connected people by seeing who co-occurs with whom in the photographs. And then expanded that by allowing the participants to verify relations, remove relation, confirm identity, question the identity, discuss what up or what down the identity. And I am going to go through examples. For example, from seeing the social graph of what the system has defined, they can switch between the validated co-occurrences. These are those for which a user has said, yes, I agree and I support this view, or all possible uncertain co-occurrences, which are all those possibilities the system has found out it could exist. And in that way, relate a personal perspective to a system perspective and the other way around. They could then, of course, inspect individual people and to whom they are related and why. What are the documents connecting them? They could also add documents to support certain connection. They could add photos and annotate photos, not only with the information about the persons they see, but what is also very much important for them is like in which context these persons have met, what was the place, what was the occasion, what were they discussing, and so on and so forth, thus enriching the underlying data collection, which again can enrich the construction of the relationships. Also, again, this process is crucial when the suggestions for individual personal identifications are presented. People can support or downvote a certain proposition that, for example, Thyssen has proposed. They can provide their own, and they can also argue for or against the proposition by another user. And what they do is then automatically translated into taking up the most valid proposition on the identity, where there is most agreement between the users, into the correcting the relationships in the graph. There is a problem here that while we can do that on the whole graph, one problem we haven't solved yet is actually what we would need to do is that for each person who does that, the user should be able to select which kind of relations should be taken in his or her graph and which kinds should be left out, because this may highly depend not just only on the person but on the specific scope of my investigation at the moment. So to make it short and to show you how this works, we've added an additional function which was very critical for users, and it is posing queries. Namely, for these users, what is interesting in the data is not just what can they see in the data, but what kind of questions they could or should be asking about the data, about what kind of insights they should be worrying about. If these people co-occur frequently, what does this tell us? And what should we now ask in order to find out whether this is important or not? And they can pose inquiries to their peers, which are then distributed to Twitter, and the answers are directly integrated here. And they can be then used to resolve, for example, who is this person behind François Mitterrand there? And why does this person appear in 10, 15 photos between them, and we never heard a thing about him, don't even know who or what his or her name is? And these are exactly questions that they're mostly interested in, not the famous persons, but those who are not the obvious ones to be identified and which we can't identify with automatic identification because we don't have the reference portraits to compare them against. So how we put this in practice, and I'm going to skip this is just maybe by looking at the demo video.
The bird's eye view of the graph. Like you can see here the entire network of connections, and you can zoom in here and you can zoom out to get an overview, making out patterns on the larger scale. You can also have a look at connections between two persons. So here you see it is made up of these two group photos that show both Helmut Kohl and Hans-Friedrich Genscher. See their connections, it's highlighted in the graph. There are several filters available, for example, the time filter that allows you to narrow down the network to a certain time period, and you can move this time period back and forth. The filter on the left-hand side let you, for example, filter by the number of connecting documents between persons. Here, you are left with, for example, a connection between Anna and Hallstein, supported by four matching multimedia networks that depict both of them. For more in-depth contextual exploration of relationships, you can also zoom into the ego graph of a particular person. For example, we take Helmut Kohl and he's selected. So you see him and you see all the connections. In addition to the photographs that make up the graph, you can look at related content. So let's take Helmut Kohl and Margaret Thatcher. So you can see some text documents that refer to both Helmut Kohl and Margaret Thatcher. Let's assume we are working with this particular photograph here. You see all the faces are marked, and you see who's in them. So this is Oscar Lafontaine. You see also that one person is yet still unknown. You might want to know who this is as part of your research, and you might want to add some metadata that you want to know. So you can go and annotate all the metadata fields. The annotated person is here. Let's go ahead and take.
Okay, I'm gonna stop the video here because I've explained most of the other things so far. This was just to give you an impression of how the system actually is working in practice. So, to conclude my talk, I just want to use the remaining 2 minutes to walk you briefly through what did we find out in the evaluation. Was it worthwhile, and what possible added value did we have from this approach that we've taken? I've skipped the part how exactly the perspectives map and so on and so forth, but you can look it up in the slides. Well, of course, we've asked the people about how do they find these different kinds of manual interventions in changing the correlation, which are reflected also in the data model changes. And the answers were yes, this is what is essential for them, these possibilities of influencing the visualization that is reflected in the data structure and then in the actual structure of the visualization and not just a certain view of it. We've also asked them about how they feel about this usage of system-generating visualization and these collaboratively created relations, because this is what they effectively do based on the inspiration they find from the system-generated result. And actually, what the result shown is that this is related to trustworthiness of information. So, on one hand, it's related to the motivation to use the system. So they basically says that as soon as there is a crowd, either that verifies the system results, this increases the motivation, but only if there is some information about the backgrounds of the poor people who from this crowd of people contribute this information. And also what was very said is the combination of this system-based and crowd-based relationship investigation and verification. This has also been considered central in accepting the usefulness of the system. So verify the automated image analysis or the automated image analysis verified by anonymous general crowd is kind of met with very mixed feelings. The usage of this automated analysis verified by anonymous crowds of people from the field or the manual analysis, and that's very interesting, performed by the expert crowd, who found the most useful. And that's also where we see how difficult this often is in certain areas to bring in this kind of technology, because these guys would have actually preferred, let's all do it by ourselves. Why? Because then we are sure that we know exactly where the data comes from, how we put it in, how we manipulated it, why the presentation looks like that, and why we reached the insights. And this cannot be stressed out, the importance of this enough. And this is actually something which is very difficult also to implement in this kind of systems, to support this full understandability, transparency of the process from the provenance and data through the construction of the visualization to the reasons for developing certain insights. What also came out from group discussion is this possibility to represent multiple perspectives as essential for them to actually work with the system. And also, what was very important is this question of uncertain co-occurrences or relationships and validated relationships. Why they all said that they are more likely to use the system for the part which represents the validated relationship by the human person. In the group discussions, but also in some of the responses, came the idea that, but also, the uncertain co-occurrences are very important because they allow us to discover possible hypotheses, which are not yet known or validated by others. And this is why we had also this perspective switch from what is kind of validated to what is non-validated, and the movements between the two perspectives. And finally, the provenance not only of data, but information of source of information, and explanations of endorsements for why the people have, why users have suggested certain things. And I'm finishing here. So to summing it up, what we've tried to do or found out is that what this reconceptualization helps us is to find ways to go maybe one step beyond what is commonly done in collaborative visual analytics and which steps the collaboration influences the visualization process to what we call a multi-perspective collaborative visualization, which basically helps us find ways to influence the visualization process in each individual step of it, from the data acquisition analysis through the structuring, manipulation, exploration, and insights, and connecting these insights to these changes in intermediate steps. And of course, with the challenge that when we do that, we are likely to have to decide where we want to allow this, not based on what we can do, but based on the priorities of the application field and the user needs in the process, in order to keep the complexity of the system manageable, both in technical terms, but above all for the acceptance by the user. And this is why at the moment we feel this kind of system are most likely to be implementable or designable for very specific application contexts. And this is what we have been trying to do also in other scenarios in which we find out that, I'm not going to talk about this, but to finish it up, which we found out that this also opens up the space. If we put collaboration in center and consider how to extend it by visualization through these kind of models, all of a sudden completely different scenarios of use open up, which we may overlook when we're just considering visualization itself. So we've tried this kind of thing in supporting sales agent and customer cooperation in a travel advisory, by providing kind of a visual multi-perspective systems, allowing them to personalize the offers and find the best solutions, and found out it actually worked very well and did a full pilot project to a company implementing this kind of system. So I leave you the slides for later to check out the things I wasn't able to present. That was the story of what could happen, and if we try to ask the question, how can we think differently about ways we integrate visualization and collaboration, and what could we do and possibly achieve, and what challenges we would need to solve if we try to put collaboration first when designing collaborative visual analysis systems. Thank you very much for your patience and attention.
Jasminko, thank you very much. That was extremely interesting, the whole thing. I think what I'm going to do, because I shouldn't say the word copy, before you ask people to do something together.
I think everybody, the coffee was the wrong word. I think everybody's inclined to get some coffee. So I think we can take it on that and wait it at a coffee break.
Well,
I'm
okay,
not going to overdo it.
There's one last thing to do, and that is because anybody just arrived, you don't know that we have a tradition giving each of our speakers an engraved whiskey tumbler as a memento for taking part in a VASS.
Thank you very much. Good luck. I took some luggage to.